in general, those who are stronger take away the subjectivity of those who are weaker. And the fact that they are weaker is the very excuse that we use them. So men in society in general objectify women. This is what we call patriarchy. And people objectify animals, which is what we call speciesism. And usually it is bodies which are objectified. So publicly, women are often portrayed as sexual objects. Female bodies can advertise anything you can imagine, from cars to beer to suits to antiperspirants. And I will show you some examples in a moment. And of course, female body parts are shown up close in these commercials. So it seems as if the women that these body parts belong to are actually not humans, but consist of these body parts only. And women as props, as hostesses, sexualized women in music videos are all things that you've seen before, I'm sure. So here are a few examples. The first one is extremely shocking, actually. It says, it means in English, she knows what will be in her mouth in a second. And this is an energy drink. It's being advertised in this way. The good news is that this company had to pay a big fine and apologize publicly for the commercial. But there are many other commercials in which nobody has to apologize and people see it as something normal or something that they're used to. So some other examples include this. Even a social ad for being an organ donor uses sexualized images of women. So the second one says, becoming a donor is probably your only chance to get inside her. The first one on the left is an antiperspirant commercial. And here you have a suit commercial and a car commercial. So I think you get the picture. Here, a vodka commercial, and the second one, believe it or not, is the meat shop commercial. So like I said, bodies are objectified. And when I speak to feminists, of course, they already know this, and they've seen these commercials, they've been bewildered at them. And what I say to them is, analogically, isn't it the same with animals? We women are treated as sexual objects, but animals are treated as things, as objects in society. And they can be consumed, they can be used for clothing, for anything you can imagine also, for entertainment, and for experiments. And ironically, animals also appear in advertisements, oftentimes as the happy cows, the happy chickens, the happy pigs, who are there to offer you their own flesh or their own milk mix. And I will show you a few examples of this in a moment. So in general, both women and animals live in systems of violence in which their bodies serve somebody else. And in order to, if we allow any group or species to be objectified, we agree to the process itself, of objectification itself. So even if this goes away for women one day, if we agree for it to continue for animals, it will surely come back and touch other groups as well, perhaps again women. So here are some examples of animals, and when I show this to feminists, I ask them, is this any different than what we've just seen for women? Milk and also a pig. I think this one is the most touching. And there are a few other parallels in the process of objectification. Of course, in general, it's denying someone's ability to think, to feel, and to need. And women, oftentimes, are viewed as being closer to animals. Of course, more in some countries than others, in some areas of the world than others. They are viewed as being closer to animals than to men, or more like animals than humans. We women are often denied rationality, or having as much rationality as men, because we're guided by hormones, of course, by emotions. We are biologized and full of many instincts, including the maternal instinct. And obviously, what comes from this, we are thought of as being worse leaders, incapable of taking on important roles, or doing this as well as men do. And also having mathematical, IT talents or skills, or even being bad drivers. Of course, we can always man up or grow hair, and that's better. So analogically, society denies that animals have social needs, that they have intelligence, empathy, that they are subjective and sentient beings. And the treatment of both women and animals shows how hierarchical a society we live in. And many people portray this as a hierarchy of men, then women, children, and animals at the very bottom. And here's three examples of commercials which managed to offend both women and animals at once. believe it or not, the one at the top is actually a website of a chicken slaughterhouse in Poland. So they've used an almost naked woman in a bikini here to advertise the slaughterhouse. So I'm sure we all wish it would look more like this, to show how conscious and sentient beings animals are. But unfortunately, it's not like that yet. And the second interconnection I want to move to is language. And this is a kind of bridge between objectification that I just spoke about and violence, which I will speak about in a moment. So the first step to justifying violence is to objectify someone. When you take away their dignity and rights, when somebody becomes an object or a thing in your eyes, it becomes kind of okay to hurt them. Because how can you hurt a thing or an object? And somebody who is always less than, so a woman, also deserves less, right? And the oppressive language that we use towards women and towards animals is an inevitable part of these systems of violence that we call patriarchy, where women are portrayed as sexual objects and animals are the things that you can use. So in essence, both are products. Of course, animals even more so than women. And language has a very funny way of belittling harm done to both women and animals. I observe this mainly in the Polish language, but I will show you some examples in English, and hopefully you'll have some in German as well. So when we belittle harassment, for instance, sexual harassment, we often say things like, boys will be boys, and don't be so dramatic. You know, it's only a compliment, it's just what men do. And what was she wearing that night to rape victims? She was asking for it, you know. And, you know, it's only a compliment, so where's your sense of humor? And towards animals, we often use the term humane killing. And here I ask feminists, can any killing really be humane? Is it not the same oppressive language that we use towards women? And what about species regulation that hunters often use? Or when we call dead animals meat, fur, when we count them in kilos or tons instead of as individuals? I'm sure you have many of these. Maybe you can shout out some German idioms, for instance, for women. Do you know any? In Polish we have, for instance, końskie zaloty, which is kind of belittling what little boys do to little girls, like pulling their bras and stuff. It's considered a compliment. And this idiom kind of shows that it's okay to do this. So I'm sure it's like that in many languages. And sometimes, this is also interesting, when we want to offend someone, especially women, we often use animal names for this. So a woman can be called a bitch, a cow, a hen, a pig. Of course, this is used towards men as well, sometimes. But in Polish especially, we have about 10 or 15 animal names used only for women, which are extremely offensive. And there are other activities like barking, yapping, being bitchy, and of course all the vulgar words and expressions that you can possibly imagine. And these are used almost exclusively towards women. And the big question is, why are animal qualities offensive in the first place, kind of like feminine ones are? Like I said, in Poland we have tons and tons of animal names which are offensive to women. And actually, Polish feminists have used this to their advantage. There's a term that called a house hen or a home hen, which is an offensive way to call a woman who takes care of children and stays at home. And we've used this image as the women's strike to encourage women to come to a protest, with one of the biggest protests in Europe recently, and to sign a petition. And what I'm trying to say here is that contempt towards women and animals goes hand in hand, and language is a tool to do this. And violence, the next interconnection I will tell you about, is enabled by language. We often don't see how strong a tool language is, how dangerous it can be as well. So I will talk about two things here with violence. The first one is about domestic violence, because research has shown clearly, and there have been many, many pieces of research since the 70s, proving how strongly domestic violence is connected to violence towards animals, especially domestic animals. Here are a few data. I won't go into the details of all of them because of a lack of time, but just to tell you, to name a few, animal abusers are 5 times more likely to to commit violent crimes against people, mainly women. This is done by the Massachusetts Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. The American Psychiatric Association uses animal cruelty as one of its diagnostic criteria for conduct disorder. And FBI profilers even use animal abuse as one of the most important indicators of violence behavior in the future towards humans. And also 71% of battered women in research shelters have said that their abuser, their partner, has either harmed or threatened to harm their domestic animals. And one of the consequences of this is that as part of their violence towards their wives and their partners, men threat to hurt domestic animals or do threat domestic animals, even killing them, to hurt these women even more because they love their domestic animals, their companions. And many shelters for women around the world do not accept animals. So this leads to many large numbers of women, this is also proved by research, of women who decide to stay at home with their offender in order to protect their domestic companion. And some other interconnections here include the fact that it's extremely difficult for victims of violence to find help, to seek help. Women are oftentimes ashamed to seek help, or they can be just, they're not believed when they tell people that they've been victims. And animals obviously can't file a lawsuit, can't seek help by themselves. I'm not sure whether this is the case in Germany, but in Poland, usually when this is brought to the attention of the judicial system, whether it's violence towards women, domestic violence, or violence towards animals, which is often brought to the attention of judicial systems by women, mainly by women, this is usually dismissed by courts, either because of a lack of evidence or they consider it to be such a small crime, a petty crime, not worth investigating. And finally, violence is universal, which means that the mechanisms of violence are absolutely the same no matter who the victim is. And that's why this is kind of an interchangeable violence. It can be towards women or towards animals or towards children, because the main, it's caused mainly by the perpetrator's sense of power over the weaker victims. So to end violence towards women, we have to end all types of violence because it's all interconnected. And the second part of violence that I want to talk about very briefly is it perhaps a bit more controversial, but we often say that violence is gendered when we talk about violence towards women, because violence is mainly towards women. However, if you take a closer look at factory farming, you'll notice that female animals are also treated slightly differently because of their sex, and the tortures that they have to go through are also different. They're long-lasting, and they include, for instance, forced insemination, which adds to a normalization of rape culture in society. It's also continuous pregnancy, which leads to many health problems. And it's taking away babies without consideration for the mother's pain, like cows, for instance. So you can say that female animals are objectified to an even greater degree than male animals, because they're not just consumed, but they're also used as producers, as incubators. They live a life of torture and disastrous conditions, and ultimately end up on human slaves as well. So, when I talk to more radical crowds, more radical feminist crowds, I sometimes ask them whether we should consider, as feminists, whether we should consume the bodies of rape and torture animals. And the last final interconnection I want to speak about is inconvenience. As you know, as most men know, it's extremely inconvenient to acknowledge the full equality of women and men in society, because this would obviously mean fewer privileges and more obligations for women, for men, sorry. So, just to name a few, this would be equal pay, parity in parliaments, no tolerance for harassment, high penalties, and invisible penalties for violence, and moreover, true equality at home, so more chores, for instance. Analogically, is it not the same with animals? What if we accepted, as feminists, that animals are not capable just of feeling pain, but that much, much more? They are actually subjective, complicated beings who have their own needs, their own emotions, they have an internal life and a social life. If we were to acknowledge this fully as humans, would it not mean that we have to completely change our ways, what we ending the objectification of animals, it felt inconvenient just for the meat industry or the animal products lobby in general, but for society as a whole in general, just as is the full equality environment. So to sum up, the talk that I give to feminists, the aim of both of our movements is to minimize suffering and to provide dignity for those who deserve it and who have been deprived of it. And it's not just the position of society that I've spoken about that connects us or the guiding values of our movements, but absolutely everything that we have to endure in society is interconnected. So it's objectification, language, violence, and inconvenience. So we depend on one another. And I say to feminists, as your fellow feminists, I urge you to join and support the animal rights movement, not just in the name of solidarity, but also for our own good as women as well. And since here I'm speaking to the vegan rights movement, not the feminist movement, I would also encourage you to take a closer look at the feminist movement, because we are very close to each other, and it's worth engaging in both. So, what you've just heard is the talk I usually give to feminists, and that's just one of the things that I do in Poland to connect the two movements. Some others include, for instance, the Animal Center at the Women's Congress, that I will talk about in a minute, a ministry for animals in the shadow cabinet of the same Women's Congress, involving the big women's strike in animal rights protests, and inviting feminists to speak at animal events, to encourage them to feel more part of the movement and to be its voice also in the feminist circle. And obviously engaging some prominent feminist celebrities to talk about animals. So the Animal Center at the Women's Congress, first of all, a few words about the Women's Congress. 5 minutes, okay. It's the largest movement in Poland at the moment. It has many, many events, but it's most known for the Congress it has once a year with up to 5,000 attendees. It consists of debates, lectures, and workshops grouped in 15 to 20 centers, which range from women in politics, diverse story, media, you name it. And so far, although there has been a green center for years, it's been focused mainly on ecological issues, everyday life issues for women. There hasn't been the topic of animals, apart from domestic animals, ever before. This year, we managed to introduce the first animal center. At the Women's Congress, it consisted of 4 debates. The first one was the talk I just gave to you, with some other celebrities and feminists. The second one was about stopping hunters, and here women who actually go to the woods and stop hunters debated about how to do this. The third one was a meeting with women who fight with fur farms, and also broiler farms in the regions, and organized protests. And the fourth one was more like a workshop, a kind of step-by-step guide of how to change your consumer behaviors to make better decisions for animals. It was kind of an easy way to start, so not going vegan right away, but for people who have never been interested in this topic, to just begin somehow, and for instance, stop buying caged eggs as a first step. And we were at first a bit scared because there were only 5 people in the audience during the first 5 minutes. No, the first 2 minutes. So we started a bit later, and then the crowd started pouring in completely, unexpectedly, and they didn't fit in the room. So it turned out that we feminists were deeply interested in this topic, and it was a great success. It exceeded our expectations. And it was one of the largest audiences of all the centers that year, so that kind of shows that feminists really care about animals and want to know more. And it will continue for the years to come. We don't have much time yet, so I have some lessons learned and best practices here. I won't talk about them now, but if you're interested, we can talk after the speech in the Times next door. I can tell you about, if you want to do this in your countries, some of the things I've learned, some of the mistakes I've made that I'd like to share with you. And my very quick take-home message is that if you're a fellow feminist and an animal lover, use these arguments I presented in your countries, in your feminist circle, to convince more people, because we really need all the allies we can get in the animal movement. And this same goes for other movements. If you're involved in any human rights movements or LGBTI movements or any place where you can see similarities and common goals, use this to involve people. Because research has proven that activists who are active in one field already are much more much. And please remember that to talk about veganism is to threaten those I think.